Hello, I specifically began looking into the drug Metronidazole over quarantine because I adopted a German Shepherd puppy who had giardiasis, a parasitic infection. When I took him to the vet, they prescribed him Metronidazole, a pill he took while eating his food. The first time he took this medication, it didn't work completely. Some of his symptoms decreased, but it was evident that the antibiotic did not completely kill off the parasite. When I took him back to the vet, he was prescribed the same medication, just in a higher dose. After the next round of antibiotics were given, his symptoms were gone, showing that the antibiotics had worked. My mother is a nurse practitioner, and she informed me that metronidazole is also prescribed in humans as well. This idea was very intriguing to me, and I became more interested in antibiotics and the different ways antibiotics can be used. I'm Madisen Seastrum, and I'm going to share a few things that I learned about metronidazole with you today. I'd like to thank Dr. Smesko for mentoring me throughout this process. Antibiotics are one of the most common drugs prescribed in healthcare. They kill bacterial cells and prevent an infection. Antimicrobials achieve bacterial death by preventing cellular respiration or inhibiting specific cellular functions. An antibiotic is a low molecular substance produced by a microorganism that at a low concentration inhibits or kills other microorganisms. An antimicrobial is any substance of natural, semi-synthetic, or synthetic origin that kills or inhibits the growth of microorganisms but causes little or no damage to the host. Antibiotics are classified into two groups based off their method, bactericidal or bacteriostatic. For this research, we will specifically be looking into bactericidals. Bactericidals inhibit DNA synthesis, RNA synthesis, cell wall synthesis, and more. Bactericidals are crucial for the killing of bacteria since bacteria often results in disease. Table 1 to the right shows some of the examples of bacteriostatic and bactericidal antibiotics. As you can see, metronidazole is shown under the bactericidal section. Metronidazole is known as a strong bactericidal and can be used to treat a multitude of different infections, some of these including bacterial and parasitic infection. It is available in many different forms, such as gel, cream, and liquid, and tablets, in which is the antibiotic that my dog was given. Some of the uses for metronidazole include helping with bite wounds, clostridioides, Crohn's disease, post-surgical resection management, giardiasis, and more. Figure 3 to the right shows the bacteria Giardia lamblia, which was the parasite that my dog was infected with. With metronidazole being said to be so effective, but yet so many doses may be needed to completely get rid of the bacteria, antibiotic resistance must be considered. In recent research, it was shown that metronidazole analogs have been used to help with antibiotic resistance. Some of the analogs used included MTZBR, MTZI, and MTZ itself. The researchers used multiple mechanisms and reactions to gain analogs that will give promising results that would help treat giardiasis. In this specific research experiment, only metronidazole will be considered to see its specific effectiveness without it being paired with other antibiotics or analogs. With the idea that antibiotic resistance is so prevalent, I looked into a research study where metronidazole resistance has been seen directly. It was stated that 50% of resistance cases found in children in Africa were for metronidazole. Thus, resistance rates in the pediatric population need to be monitored. Again, showing the importance of metronidazole and its uses and effectiveness. Specifically, in my research project with Dr. Smesko, we will be looking into the effectiveness of metronidazole when it is added to a variety of bacterial strains, these both being gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria. The gram-positive bacteria that will be used will be Staphylococcus aureus, and for the gram-negative bacteria, E. coli will be used, both of these being easy to grow and easy to work with. Specifically in this research experiment, metronidazole will be applied to these bacteria on which The drug will be dissolved so that a few microliters will be applied to a paper disc, and it will be applied to an agar plate on which the bacteria will grow. Then the morphology of the bacteria will be observed, and a variety of metronidazole concentrations will be used to see how much is needed to achieve cell death of the bacteria. Or in other words, the metronidazole amount will be varied to show how much metronidazole is needed for the drug to be effective. Hopefully this experiment will show how effective metronidazole is and which bacteria are more resistant than others. In addition to this, hopefully it will help decide if metronidazole is the correct antibiotic for treating these two strains of bacteria, thus gaining knowledge upon how to combat bacteria and infection more adequately. For this procedure, first, the gram-negative and gram-positive bacteria will be grown. The experimental group will involve both the bacterial strands being applied with metronidazole. Then the bacteria will be observed 2 hours later under a fluorescent microscope. This will be done to observe any changes that there may be in the morphology of the bacteria. If nothing has changed, or if more of the drug needs to be added, it will be. And then, after 2 more hours, the process will be continued until desired results are obtained. The control group will be just bacteria with no metronidazole added. This bacteria will just grow as the other bacteria hopefully shows results. The data will be recorded, and hopefully knowledge will be gained upon the mode of action of the drug and the zone of inhibition throughout the process. Figure 4 and figure 5 show the cell shape of E. coli and Staphylococcus aureus. Staphylococcus aureus is found on human skin. It can lead to skin and soft tissue infections such as abscesses, boils, and more. E. coli are typically found in the intestines of people and animals, and they can also be found in food. They can cause diarrhea, urinary tract infections, respiratory illnesses, and bloodstream infections. When looking at the morphology changes, shape, size, structure, and arrangement of bacterial cells will be looked at. The basic shapes include spherical, rod-like, and helical. In certain bacterial cells, they are arranged in pairs of clusters, chains, trachoma, and filaments. All of these details will be looked at, and they will be looked into when we observe the bacteria before and after metronidazole is applied. Figure 6 to the left shows morphological changes that occur to both E. coli cells, which are A and B, the top two, and Staphylococcus aureus cells, C and D, the bottom two, after they are altered by morphological changes. The cell wall and the texture of the cells should be considered, this showing that hopefully in this experiment, the cell wall will be altered and the texture of the cells should also be looked at. This research has helped me to better understand antibiotics, how they work against microorganisms, and antibiotic resistance. These new understandings also helped me to understand the issues that my dog Bentley had been going through. I now better understand why antibiotics had to be given to him a second time and how strong certain parasites and bacteria are when it comes to resisting antibiotics. When the procedure is completed, this will also help to visually see how effective metronidazole is against the two bacterial strands, thus giving more knowledge and gaining more knowledge upon the drug's effectiveness. Additional studies may include the calculation of zone inhibition for each strain exposed to various concentrations of metronidazole, investigation into resistance used exposed cells, but still viable cells, will be used to start additional colonies and monitor drug concentration and the amount that is needed to cause cell death.